This is the overview of my presentation, divided in three parts. The first part is devoted to the role of intermediate filaments in human pathology. In the second part, I will carry out an overview of Charcot-Marie-Tooth disease, focused on clinical electrophysiological classification and nosology of the controversial intermediate subtype. And the third part is devoted to the phenotypic description of CNT associated with NfL E396K mutation. Intermediate filaments may be cytoplasmic and nuclear. Cytoplasmic are keratins in epithelia, vimentin or vimentin related in glial cells, neurofilaments in nerve cells, and finally, nuclear lamins in all animal cells. This is a diagram illustrating the general structure of intermediate filaments, consisting of a head domain, a rod domain with several alpha helical areas, and finally the tail domain. The neurofilaments are divided in three subtypes according to the molecular weight, with low, median, and high molecular weight. Neurofilaments are the major intermediate filaments of adult neurons. They increase the axonal caliber of myelinated axons and therefore increase the conduction velocity. And they contribute to the dynamic properties of the axonal cytoskeleton during neuronal differentiation and axonal growth, regeneration, and guidance. Here we can see three examples of intermediate filaments abnormalities and human pathology. GFAP mutations are associated with Alexander disease, which is a type of leukodystrophy. Neuronal alpha internexin inclusion disease is the pathological hallmark of frontotemporal dementia subtype of a type. And finally, NfL mutations are associated in around 1% of cases with CMT. There have been reported 20 NfL heterozygous mismutation targeted the head and the rod domain, and which are associated until now with dominant axonal CMT, CMT2E, or dominant demyelinating CMT, CMT1F. The current mutation here, E396K, is a gene hot spot. NfL mutation may cause extremely variable semiology, ranging from mild late onset forms to early onset and severe phenotypes. And this is not new, because this was the fact in the original description. See here, the second case described by Tooth, showing asymmetric and moderate peroneal muscular atrophy. In contrast with this, see here severe clinical picture with massive amyotrophy of the lower legs, pescabus varus, atrophy of forearms and hand of muscles of the hand, and initiating clawing of the hand, described in the case finding by Tejorin and Sotas more than one century ago. In clinical practice, CMT is classified in agreement with the inheritance pattern and the results of nerve conduction studies. In this way, we distinguish autosomal dominant CMT, which may be CMT1 demyelinating with median conduction velocity below 38 meters per second, CMT2 axonal with median nerve motor conduction velocity above 38 meters per second, autosomal recessive CMT, the same considerations, adding AR before the CMT. And finally, X-linked CMT, which may be axonal, demyelinating, or even intermediate. But what intermediate CMT has been a controversial notion. There are authors denying the existence of this type of CMT. Let me summarize the original descriptions of intermediate CMT. This is a designation introduced by Davis and colleagues in 1974 for cases with peroneal muscular atrophy not fitting in CNT1A or CNT2. These patients had no palpable enlarged nerves, motor conduction velocity of the median nerve range from 25 to 45 meters per second, in other series between 30 and 40, with preserved CMAP amplitude. This is crucial, the CMAP amplitude. The condition to describe the intermediate pattern is in patients not having reduction of the distal motor potential. A nerve biopsy showing predominantly an axonal pathology with occasional presence of onion bulbs. This is the actual or the present panorama of CNT. The total is 66 genes and counting. And see here that we are adding CNT1, for example, A to F in chronological order of the appearance of the discoveries of the genes. This is ironic that a very simple disease is probably one of the most genetic complex disorders. And concerning dominant intermediate CNT, there are six loci. I leave aside the mutation in connexin 32 because this is an oblique transmission, not a dominant transmission. Okay, the first description of CNT, dominant intermediate CNTA, was described in an Italian family, but the gene remains unknown. B is mutations in the dynamin 2 genes. C is correspond to mutations in JARS gene. D in MPZ gene. E in inverted forming 2, producing an actinopathy with glomerulosclerosis. This is a very, very selective disease, a very attractive disease. And finally, mutation in GMB4, which is a protein G, causes the phenotype F. But you see, the, until now, no dominant intermediate CNT associated with NFL mutation has been reported. Now, I will focus on the family we have studied in the last two decades. This pedigree comprises four individuals, affected individuals, the Provan, 3-1, two brothers and his mother, and we also examined four members of the second generation, affected members of the second generation. We include here the electropherograms showing a change G2A in position 1186, giving rise to a mutation, glutamic 396 to lysine. Later on, I will explain the genetic strategy followed in this family. This is the problem. The problem was attended for the first time in 1993 at age 17. He was referred to us by his podiatrist due to forefoot pescabus and gait clumsiness initiated in infancy. Initial examination at age 17 showed pescabus, difficulty in heel walking, areflexia, stocking hypostasia, rest hypotonia, and mild spastic gait, and finally, extensor plantar responses. The following video will illustrate the evolution of semiology between the last 10 years. Charcot-Marie-Tooth disease neuropathy, this is a combination of electrophysiological data and clinical data, gave a score of 24 indicating severe disease. We classify 1 to 10 is light, 11 to 20 moderate, and more than 21 or more severe disease. And now you see the video. We are stands at age 29. You see mild peroneal muscular atrophy. In 2000, the appearance is not very impressive. You see mild lower leg atrophy, but now see gait. There is a gait with some spastic gait, with some waddling appearance, difficulty tiptoeing, inability to walk on the heels, and see 10 years later, you see a steppage, a waddling gait, and at the same time some spastic component. This is a very complex semiology. hands. In 2004, there is my amyotrophy of the hands, but 10 years later, there is a clear, very clear atrophy of the first interocyte and flattening of the thenar eminency and some clawing. There was no limitations in upper limbs. There was no proximal weakness. His mother is a woman aged 59, initially evaluated at 38 as a secondary case. She was completely at home with, she never went to a doctor, in fact. At that time, she recognized walking difficulty initiated at the first decade. As I stated, in spite of this, she never went to a doctor. Initial evaluation was similar to that of her son, and CNTNS was indicates a severe disease. At the score is 26. And see here the video. 2004, 49 years of age. The appearance is minimal lower leg atrophy. There is no clear progression because of the fatty infiltration of the legs. But now see gait. There is a wobbling component and perhaps a spastic gait. See here difficulty tiptoe walking and inability to walk on the heels. And 10 years later, see here, it's almost impossible. She needs support for walking. There is a wobbling component, a step pitch. Here I will not be able to say that there is a spastic component. See the appearance of the hand here, atrophy of the first dorsal interocyte, but 10 years later, a marked atrophy of the hands. And see plantar response. You see, the plantar response is extensive. Okay. The brother of the older brother of the prover, who is 26 years in 2004, 26 years in 2014, 36 years. You see incipient but not clear atrophy of the first interocyte, but 10 years later there is progression with clear atrophy of the first dorsal interocyte, and you see here asymmetric peroneal muscular atrophy. At the age of 26, you see here, even if hypertrophy of the posterior muscle compartment of the lower leg, and 10 years later there is progression of the lower legs with disappearance of the hypertrophy. Clinical examination in patients of the second generation was normal. We carried out routine laboratory studies which were normal excepting for a slight to moderate elevation of CK levels. Because the patient had spasticity, the dynamic spasticity and plantar, extensor plantar responses, we carried out cranial MRI or CT scan which were normal, and we didn't perform sural nerve biopsy. See here nerve conduction studies. We carried out examination of median, ulnar, peroneal, and tibial nerves, but I asked in order to summarize the results, see here the results of median nerve conduction studies. In all patients, range from 34 to 43 meters per second, normal is greater than 49 meters per second. In our series of CNT1A, 20 meters, that is to say, intermediate between CNT1A and normality. Median, the F wave range from 37 to 41 milliseconds, normal 31 in CNT1A, again 50, again between normality and CNT1A. We recorded the bicep T reflex and we obtained values of ranging between 18 and 20 and to 22 milliseconds, normal, lower than 55, and in CNT1A 29, against the results are between the normality and CNT1A. An electromyography showed chronic denervation with just spontaneous denervation in tibialis anterior. And see here the recording of median nerve. You have here the segment elbow to wrist segment. We are stimulating here in the wrist, here in elbow, and we are obtaining a monophasic potential with severe reduction. In normal condition is greater than 4 millivolts, and here is not 0.6, not 0.4 millivolts. This is an indication of loss of large myelinated fibers, and the obtained motor conduction velocity is 36 meters per second. And one may wonder whether this reduction could be accounted for by reduction of large myelinated fibers. To clarify the issue, we analyze the segment axilla to elbow with recording in flexor digitorum superficialis. Then, when we stimulate it in elbow, we obtain this potential of 7, 8 millivolts with biphasic morphology, and we stimulate it in axilla, we obtain the same potential. This is normal motor potentials, but motor conduction velocity 44, this value, for this segment, normal values are over 54 meters per second, are again in the intermediate segment. And we cannot state that this conduction, this slowing, cannot be attributed to reduction of CMAP because the amplitudes are completely normal. These electrophysiological findings indicate that the current NFR mutation causes length-dependent axonopathy and primary conduction slowing in the intermediate range. Because we have abnormal pyramidal signs, we carried out multimodal evoked potentials and EEG. EEG and visual evoked potentials were systematically normal. Blind reflex, we didn't show the recordings, showed delay of R2 potentials, indicating a dysfunction of the descending trigeminal tract. We observed abnormalities of acoustic potentials, the interpeak 1 to 3 or 1 to 5, indicating also abnormalities of central auditory conduction pathways. And I will show you the results of motor evoked potential and somatosensory evoked potentials. See here somatosensory evoked potentials in patient 3-2 of median nerve. We are stimulating the median nerve in the wrist, and you obtain inert point in a cervical vertebra 7 and in parietal cortex. And you see that there is a delay of the responses, as might have been expected from the slowing of peripheral conduction. But when you analyze the central conduction time, this is delayed to 9.8 milliseconds when the normal values are lower than 6. In the same way, motor evoked potentials, we are stimulating in vertex and in 7 cervical vertebrae. If we are recording in abductor pollicis brevis, and the responses are delayed, but central motor conduction time is delayed, indicating a dysfunction of the pyramidal tract. Taken together, the observed alterations of multimodal evoked potentials indicate the polyneuropathic semiology is accompanied by Weisbrod, central nervous system, motor sensory pathway dysfunction. Imaging studies were done in 3 patients. We have 2 patients with claustrophobia, and we carried out in these patients a one-time multi-slide CT. And in the another patient, we carried out MRI using T1 and T2 fast suppress sequences. See here the coronal section of the lower limbs, the CT scan in the patient 2-4. This is a coronal section, anterior coronal section, posterior coronal section. You see axial section of the pelvis, axial section of mid-thighs, axial section of mid-lower legs and feet. Let me remind you that normal density is high for bone, for compact bone, and is low for subcutaneous fat, and muscles are the signal of muscle is intermediate. You can see here that there is a fat infiltration of distal vastus lateralis, distal infiltration of semimembranosus, whereas tibialis anterior and soleus are exhibit a clear widespread infiltration. In the pelvis you see hypodensity, fatigue atrophy of gluteus medius and gluteus minimus. In the thighs there is infiltration of the posterior compartment, but the anterior and the lateral compartments are normal. In the lower legs there is a tetracompartimental fatty infiltration predominating in the posterior one. And in the fish, there is almost a complete disappearance of intrinsic smooth muscle, including flexor hallucis brevis, lumbricals, and interossei. Clearly, this pattern of lower limb muscle changes, including distal amyotrophy and gluteus amyotrophy, correlates with the observed gait semiology combining steppage and waddling components. So extensive muscle denervation probably accounts for the observed high CK levels, and to the best of our knowledge, such pattern had not been reported in any CNT syndrome. In one patient, we carried out MRI study, and you see here T1 weighted images of the pelvis, thighs, lower legs, and feet. In normal conditions, the signal of the normal muscle is gray, intermediate gray. But where there is fat infiltration, it appears white. You see here normal structures in the pelvis, asymmetric fat infiltration of the posterior compartment of the thighs, tetracompartimental fatty atrophy of the lower legs, and massive, it's completely white, atrophy of foot musculature. In this patient, we had one unique opportunity is to carry out serial evaluation in 2012 and 14 and 2 years later. T1 here, T2 fast suppressed here, T2 here, and T2 fast suppressed here. The sections are at the same levels. You see here venous drainage anomaly, venous drainage anomaly, and you see here one important detail. In the first study, the degree of fatty atrophy of peroneus longus is moderate, but in T2 fast suppressed, you see here a high signal of this muscle. T1 increase of T1 signal indicates fatty atrophy. Increase of T2 fast suppressed signal indicates edema. This is characteristic of subacute denervation. And 2 years later, there is increasing of the degree of fatty atrophy, and there is while the high the edema subsides. That is to say, predominance of distal fatty atrophy of lower limb musculatures, but particularly of the feet, correlates well with the notion of length-dependent axonopathy. And furthermore, the increase of T2 fast suppressed signal indicates, after increasing, evolving to an increase of T1 signal, suggests one inflammatory changes or inflammatory changes superimposed on the genetic condition. And this is the genetic strategy followed in the last 22 years. In 1993, in the lab by Anita Harding, we discarded PMP22, which was the unique mutation at that time known, together with connexin 32. Our working diagnosis was hitherto unheard of intermediate CNT. Albina Jordanova, between 2004 and 2010, carried out a screening on non-mutation associated with axonal, perhaps some myelinating genes, including MPZ, dynamin 2, connexin 32, mitofusin 2, AGR2, JARS, and HSP. Finally, in 2014, the exomes of two cases were screened for 29 mutations associated with CNT1, CNT2, CNTX, and we found the current mutation, which we now know that this is a hot spot of the gene. And let me finish with the pathophysiology of the peripheral nervous system. this mutation implies change glutamic to lysine, which is a severe change according with the information of biologists. This mutation implies neurofilament dysfunction causing alteration of axonal transport. This is in animal models, it has been demonstrated. There are no autopsy studies in human beings. This involves maldevelopment of large myelinated fibers and limb-dependent axonopathy, producing selective denervation of feet or massive denervation of feet and hands, hypertrophy of large myelinated fibers and secondary demyelination, which may account for reduction of motor conduction velocity and CMAP attenuation, muscle denervation predominating in legs and thighs, but with the following pattern. In contrast with the conventional CNT, in which the peroneal musculature is severely involved, here we have a predominance of tibial over peroneal, peroneal over sciatic, sciatic over obturator, and equal to femoral. To summarize, NFLE936K mutation may manifest with a novel dominant intermediate CNT characterized by PES cavus, distal sensorimotor neuropathy, ascending lower limb weakness to involve pelvic girdle musculature, spastic gait, and to a greater degree, subclinical abnormalities of multimodal evoked potentials. This clinical electrophysiological semiology implies a simultaneous involvement of the peripheral and central nervous system. I wish to thank my colleagues at the Service of Neurology, particularly for Dr. Pelayo Negro and John Infante, Dr. García, Antonio García carried out electrophysiological recordings, Elena Gallardo imaging studies, and Dr. Els de Brin, Christian Peters, and Albina Jordanova carried out genetic analysis of the genes. Thank you very much for your attention.